Pittsburgh dream maker, Mr. Richard Simmons!
Hello! Nice to see you. Hi, how are you? Hello, dreamers! Sit down, sit down! They're wild today! Can we have a nice hand for Jerry Pentacoli?
They are wild up!
It's beautiful. Where'd you get that?
Got a new lamp.
It's beautiful. Somebody make that for you?
I don't know, but I love it.
It's gorgeous.
Don't break it.
Hey, listen, my sister just called me from Phoenix. She lives in Phoenix, Arizona. You never
told me you had a sister.
She's beautiful. She's 5 years younger than me. She and her husband live there. They've been watching every day on the NBC affiliate there. She absolutely loves the show and wanted to say a special hello to you.
Well, that's nice. Yeah. Yeah. And you and your sister.
I love my sister.
Very close.
She is like my best friend. I love her to death. She's the best woman in the world.
Well, I have to get right to my first dream because it is really so compelling. This is a dream that we've worked on for a long time. I want you to meet Dodie and her sister, Leanna. Let me sit here.
You can meet fast.
Huh?
You got to meet fast.
How are you?
Hi.
Nice to see you.
You too, Richard.
This was a very complicated dream, a very complicated story. I had to study this a lot. You wrote me an email, and you wrote me an email for different reasons, but this story and surprise is for you.
God, I knew it.
Shh, it's okay. Love between two sisters? You can't get any better than that.
That's right.
Leanna, you tried and tried and tried and tried to have a baby. Uh-huh. And you could not have a baby.
Right.
Is that correct?
Correct.
And your sister...
Don't cry on me, Richard.
I'm not going to cry on you.
Don't cry on me.
Your sister said to you, I will carry a baby for you. Since you cannot have a baby on your own and you want one so bad, I am going to carry this baby for you.
Yes.
What went through your mind when your sister said that to you?
I just couldn't believe it. I had lost 9 babies.
You lost 9 babies.
Uh-huh. And so she wanted to do this for me.
She wanted to do this for you. Uh-huh. And you carried that baby for 9 months. And beautiful baby girl.
That's the easy part, Richard.
That was the easy
part. Carrying a baby is the easy part. Raising them is the hard part. Carrying them was great.
Yeah, it's hard to carry.
I love to be pregnant.
You love to be pregnant.
I love it.
Well, it is.
I love it.
It's a gift of God.
It is,
isn't it? Don't you think?
Yeah.
I think it is.
Okay. She's a gift, yes. She's special. We hope that.
So now the baby is not a baby anymore. She's a beautiful girl.
Yes.
She's sitting right near here, and her name is Hadia. Hello, Hadia. Leanna, Hadia, that is a very beautiful and unique name. What does it mean?
It means a gift in Arabic.
It does. Dodie, why did you carry this baby for your sister?
Well, because I saw what a pain she went through, losing so many, you know, one after the other, and I could easily have them. And I love being pregnant, and I just felt it was the right thing to do.
And then after
I never questioned it.
After you carried this baby,
mm-hmm.
you wanted to carry another baby.
For her, yes.
For her.
Mm-hmm. I tried, yeah.
You tried. And
I did try a second time, then I had a miscarriage on that one. And we found out that while I was waiting for more eggs for her to produce, she had gotten pregnant. She didn't know it.
Wait a minute, hold it.
Wait. You haven't heard it yet, Richard.
Nine years, no.
Yes.
And then technology came about,
yes.
And they fixed the problem.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then you had a baby.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
And then you had
another
baby.
Another one, yeah.
So now you started
beautiful.
With none.
And have three.
And now you have three.
They're beautiful.
Really?
Her daughters are beautiful and well-behaved, wonderful kids, all three of them.
How do you thank your sister for this gift? How?
You know what?
Words you don't have. Have. You thank me every day just by the way
can
you
Can I
are
listen
her.
To your sister?
Oh, come on.
Leanna?
Don't embarrass me.
Leanna.
You know, words can never thank her. Nothing in the world can ever thank her. I love her forever.
Well, you know, I'm the dream maker.
Oh, God, Richard.
And when I read this, I mean, I never heard about this before. The generosity, a woman who is totally unselfish, a woman who loves her sister. You just heard Jerry talk about his sister, my brother, so close to me. And I want something wonderful to happen to you. I think that after carrying the baby and having this beautiful child, look at this child, look at this face. Look at this face.
That's who I thought we were coming here for. Is the
I know, but you know,
that's
I have to have
now.
Surprises.
That's my dream.
My dream for you is that that's you carried a baby, then you carried another one. You're so generous, you're so giving, that as the dream maker, I wanted to give you something special. Jerry, tell us what we're going to give Dodie.
Dodie, get ready, pack your bags. You're going to Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. At the beautiful, picturesque beachfront resort. Capture the beauty of pristine Puerto Vallarta beaches. Just for you, Dodie. Have a great time.
Oh, my God.
Your dreams are a gift. Please, as you see this, don't ever, ever forget that. Is a young lady backstage who has been a fan of General Hospital for 20 years. Well, right now, she's all the way backstage. She can't see us, she can't hear us, anything. Since I used to be on General Hospital, she thinks she's going to challenge me in a General Hospital trivia game. But I'm gonna play a whole different game with her. I'm gonna surprise her with General Hospital star Brad Maul, who plays Dr. Tony Jones. Contest, remember it's a contest. And now let's bring out our next contestant, Carla. How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
I cannot believe how long, you know, we're playing a game.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, you know about the game.
Uh-huh.
You've been watching General Hospital for over 20 years?
20 years, exactly. Ever since I was little, my mom would let me wake up just in time for my nap so I could watch it.
Now, you do remember me on General Hospital.
You were doing aerobics at the campus disco.
That's right, and... I mean, it's 20 years ago, but don't I look quite much the same?
Very similar.
I love this woman. I love this woman already. Now, we're gonna play a little game.
Okay.
Okay, and it's called Only on General Hospital. What is it called?
Only on General Hospital.
And the wonderful host of this show is your favorite and mine, Mr. Jerry Penicoli.
All right. Step up to the podiums. Welcome, Carla. Good luck. Hello, Mr. Simmons.
Hello.
Good luck to you. Okay, now you guys are competing each other. We're going to test your 20 years of knowledge, Carla, of General Hospital, okay? Now, I'm going to ask you a question about General Hospital. I will give you three answers, multiple choice. You can ring in. This is very important. You can ring in at any time, okay? Now, remember, audience, what's the game called?
Only on General Hospital.
Okay, now the winner is going to get this beautiful autographed script from all of the cast members of General Hospital.
I don't have that.
And you don't have that? Well, you better bone up on your knowledge, buddy. Okay, and
this, bone up on my knowledge?
That's right. And this General Hospital t-shirt.
I don't
okay.
have that.
All right. Is everybody focused? Is everybody ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, look over there. Look.
We're gonna... Okay, now it's best out of four, okay?
Best out of four.
Best out of four. Here we go. Question number one, and audience, please, no cheating, okay? Here we go. Which fitness expert used to give fitness classes on General Hospital? Was it Jack? Yes! Carla!
Richard Simmons.
Yes! Exactly! I heard Carla's bell first. I heard Carla's bell first. Okay, are you with me?
My bell was louder.
But I heard...
What was she doing this?
But he knew.
But I heard hers first.
Fine.
Okay. Judges, do we hear Carla's first? Yes, we did. There you go. Okay. Next question, number
the
two.
The judges are Carla's family.
Okay, question number two. Which cast member went on to marry co-star Christina Milandro? Carla!
Jack Wagner.
Yes! Jack Wagner, who romanced Heather Locklear on Melrose Place. Very good. Okay. You okay? You're gonna get in the game here?
No, I'm not okay.
You're gonna get in the game? Okay.
I'm in the game.
Okay, question number three. Before she became a nurse. Are you quite.
I'm ready.
Are you quite through?
I'm ready.
Are you gonna stop cheating? That's distracting her by putting your foot on her podium.
I thought it was good luck.
Okay. All right, here we go. Hands on bells, here we go.
Ready.
Question three. Before she became a nurse at General Hospital, she was a, quote, Richard. Yes?
You don't know.
What's the answer?
Jackie Zeman, Bobby Spencer.
Yes!
I got it! Right. All right, I got one.
Well, the question was...
When she changed.
The question was, before she became a nurse at General Hospital,
so
she was a...
loser.
She was a...
She went,
for the benefit of our viewers here, she was a lady of the evening. Good thing she kept her day job. Was it Jessie Brewer, Audrey Hardy, Bobby Spencer? It was Bobby Spencer. Okay.
Okay. And well, it seems like those scores are just going up.
Yes, it's 2-1. Carla's in the lead.
Yay!
Okay. Time for our final question. Now, I want you both to take... I want you both... to look up to the Dreammaker monitor, take a good look at this clip, and identify this doctor who had an affair with his ex-wife's daughter and thought he had a child.
I know that Lucas on the outside comes off as unscathed, but deep down I realize that I've left some scars and we have a lot of work to do together. Rebuilding and, in my case, re-earning his trust and your trust. And I just want to thank you for the chance.
Okay, and during the clip, Carla rang her bell and said, it
Dr.
is...
Dr. Tony Jones.
Who's played by?
Oh, no. Brad Mull.
Yes!
Oh!
Presented with a prize. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Good work. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Wow.
Brad. She's been watching you for so long on General Hospital. Your character on General Hospital, how is it different from your real life?
Well, I'm happily married and I have three kids, and on GH I've been sleeping with my stepdaughter and my wife left me, and I'm crazy on the show. I kidnap babies and everything now. But I'm coming back. I was misunderstood for a while.
Now, do you have any suggestions for his character?
I think you should get back with Bobby.
Me too!
All right.
But
I know she's getting married.
Yeah. Maybe, maybe.
You know, Carla, just right now here at the Dreammaker, your life has become a soap opera. Everybody, please thank our very special guest, Brad. Thank you, Brad, for coming. And say hello to everybody at General Hospital for me.
I want you back on the show.
I do, too. I want to be back on General Hospital.
You need to be a DH.
You never know when your dreams will surprise you. Dreams begin when someone sits down and writes a letter. I want you to meet a woman who writes many, many, many letters. Her letters bring hope and joy to sick children all over the United States. I would love you to meet the founder of Love Letters named Linda Bremner.
So nice to meet you. I've loved you from afar.
I've loved you from afar, too. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
I want you to tell us how Love Letters got started, because I found this to be an unbelievable organization.
Well, it began with tragedy. My 8-year-old son was diagnosed with cancer. And he went into the hospital, where he stayed only 5 days. And in 5 days' time, my family and friends generated 85 cards and letters for him. Everybody had something to tell Andy. They had to tell him they cared. And then Andy came home. He came home to fight the biggest battle of his life. He came home to fight for life. And the mail stopped.
The letters that he received?
Stopped.
Gone.
They were gone.
Because at first, everyone sends cards and letters.
Everyone does. It wasn't that my family and friends stopped caring. It was that it's very awkward to say get well soon to a child who may die. And Andy wanted the mail, he craved the mail, he needed the mail. And I knew why I couldn't cure his body, I could give him the mail. So I began to write to my son as his secret pal. And I wrote to him. A couple of weeks after I started writing to him, he was coloring at the dining room table. And I asked to see the picture and he wouldn't show it to me. And I kept asking, and he kept being evasive. And he told me it was for his secret pal. And then he gave it to me, and he told me I couldn't look at it. It was for his secret pal. So I put the letter away, and when he went to sleep, I opened it up. And at the bottom, it said, P.S. Mom, I love you. Aww. So my Andy knew that I was writing to him, and I knew that he knew. And we never spoke of it again. We played our secret pal game for 4 years until he died in 1984. At that time, when I was going through his belongings, I found in the back of a closet a shoebox, and it had the cards and the letters that I had written my son, and he had put in it an address book. And this address book was the names of kids he had gone to camp with. He went to Camp One Step at a Time, which is a camp for cancer patients. So I had 20 names of children who, like my son, were no longer getting the mail. And I thought, in Andy's memory, I could take and write them each a card or a letter. I started writing, and before I got done with the list, one of the children on the list, who didn't know me, I was just a secret pal, wrote back and said, thank you for writing me. I didn't know anyone knew I lived. And I knew at that time I would write to children as long as they needed me.
How many letters does Love Letters write and send out every week?
Over 1,100.
1,100 letters to sick children.
All over the country.
I want to know, this is quite expensive. How are you able to do all this mailing? I mean, you're one person. How do you do all the mailing?
Well, I don't do it alone. I have some wonderful volunteers that help me. I have about 30 locally and about 30 more across the country. And everything we send to a child is donated to us.
Do you have any idea how much you were loved? Not by just your family, but do you have any idea how many people love you and don't even know you? Do you have any idea?
I feel their love every day. I do.
Well, you're going to feel some more love now. There is someone here that you have been writing to for 9 years. You've been writing love letters for 9 years. Please welcome Brian and his mom, Peg. Sit down. You sit here. You sit there. You, mommy, sit here.
Well, we'll get you.
This lady has been writing you love letters for 9 years.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you receive these letters, what do you do?
Well, first of all, they make me happy and excited, and I love them. And I bought some here.
These are some that she sent?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
These are some of the ones that she sent. Look at these. This takes a lot of work, doesn't it?
Oh,
I think
yeah.
It does.
Open them up.
Peg, I know your son has been struggling with a very rare disease. Could you tell us about that?
Brian has Gaucher disease. It's type 1. He was diagnosed right before his second birthday. And the treatment that was not available. It was an experimental drug, and there were only 12 people in the experiment. And Brian was in my arms for a whole year. And we finally were able to get it because the drug came to investigational. And when it goes up to investigational, you're able to get it. It's a very expensive drug. It's not a cure. It's a treatment. But as you can see,
he's right here with us. Linda, you have done so much to help all of these children. You're just an amazing, amazing woman. And I want to keep, as a dream maker, I want to keep these love letters alive, don't we all? So, we are getting you this. A huge variety of stationery products and note cards.
We can use them.
They're also giving you a collection of pens worth over $400.
Can use those too.
We're going to give you a check for $1,000 for stamps.
You do know how to make dreams come true.
Brian, don't you think she deserves all this?
Oh yes.
Huh?
Yes.
And I heard you sometimes love to play video games. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay.
Very much.
You do. Jerry, right over here. Wow. Now, here's a present for you because I wanted the dream maker to always be in your mind. Jerry?
Brian, get ready and set that VCR because you're getting $300 worth of gift cards. Have a great time.
Take the time to sit down today and write a letter to someone you know who isn't feeling well. You'll cheer them up, but it will make you feel so great inside. Remember, a dream starts with the letter. Mailbox, and I found a letter from a woman named Julie. Her dream was one which I'm sure many of you women have all over the country. She dreamed of the day her husband would finally clean up his mess in the garage. What a mess. It was a mess. With two S's. Now you know the dream maker doesn't clean. So I sent my dream correspondent, Jerry Pentacoli, to decide if Julie and Stan would ever be able to fit their car in the garage again.
I love this. We're about to surprise an unsuspecting guy named Stan Wong. Now, his wife, Julie, emailed the dream maker and said her husband is such a mess and their garage is so disorganized, they can't even get a car in it. Come on, let's go check it out.
We don't want him to see us. He's a cop. He might be a little suspicious. Hello, Stan. My name is Jerry Pentacoli. I'm with the garage police.
No.
The garage police. This garage, from what I understand, is the pits. Is that true? Are you guilty as charged?
Yeah, that's guilty. But it's not the pits.
Do you want to show me? Okay. Prove it. Come on. Open the door. Oh, Stan.
What? There's nothing wrong with this garage.
Should we tell him?
Where are these folks?
Remember that letter I wrote? A long time ago, you laughed at me.
Yeah.
She wrote to Dream Maker, and her dream was to organize your life because she just thinks you're one big disorganized slob. But you know what? I have a feeling this is more for her than you because she wants to get her darn car in the garage, huh? There's a little selfish motivation, huh?
He's going to kill me. It's going to be Jerry Springer's show in a minute.
Julie needed to take drastic action to get the garage clean. She's pregnant, and a clean garage means more space to store the stuff that's piling up in the room that's supposed to be the nursery.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be the baby's room, but there's really no place for the baby.
Well, we have a little help for you here today. We had to call in the professionals, and they're going to help you organize your life, your garage. They're going to take care of it. Come on, you guys.
Jerry, you're going to need your hard hat.
No, I'm telling you what.
I'm here to write to him.
He's going to be doing all the work along with you guys. So get to work, all right?
You can do it, honey.
I can?
Yes, you can.
I don't know.
We can throw this out, can't we? Let me just see.
Well, I don't know.
Oh, okay, what about this coffee pot?
I can't get rid of that. That's for camping.
These. Do you need these?
No, these are my license plate frame.
Give them back.
No.
Give.
No.
Give. So now, what about this book? Okay. Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Wow. It's amazing.
You like it?
Yes. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. Come here. There you go. Keep it simple, Stan. Okay, now we're ready for the big test. We gotta see if the car's gonna fit in.
It will.
What a driver.
Wow, it does fit. Thank you, honey. Thank you, hard-headed woman.
Mwah.
And thank you, Dream Maker.
Please welcome our newly organized couple, Julie and Stan Wong! How are you? When they showed me pictures of that garage, I had to take a nap. I really had to take a nap. Did they do a great job? Did they do an unbelievable job? Now that we got the garage done, you're happy?
Very happy.
Are you happy? Are you happy?
Very happy.
Are you going to be a little neater?
Yes, I will be.
Raise your right hand. I promise.
My middle name.
Will be neat.
Will be neat.
Okay, good. Now, you said that you have another room that needs organization because you were with child. How many months pregnant are you?
I'm in my fifth month.
In your fifth month. Oh, goodness. And then I saw the room, where the baby's room, and it looked like...
There's no room for the baby.
None.
Little Richard.
Little Richard. Oh, my God. Anyway, I got something that's just going to really help do it all. Hey, my sweet Jerry, say goodbye, because we have to say hello to...
Your brand new baby furniture, Julie and Stan. Take a look. Just for you, Julie and Stan, and that beautiful new baby.
Come here and see this. All this beautiful baby.
That's amazing.
And look, we had the baby all ready for you.
Is she wet?
No, she's not wet. Hey, remember, organization, organize your dreams. Now look. I want to tell you the story of a woman who is in our audience right now. She has a job that requires her to stand on her feet all day long. And because of this, she spends her days in incredible pain. What's preventing her from getting rid of this pain? Well, she has no medical insurance, and she simply can't afford medical care. I'd like you to say hello to Bea and her daughter, Carol. Sit down. I said your name, and I saw you jump 2 feet high.
No, what? I just didn't know.
You see, I played a trick. You thought you all were just coming to see a show. But the Dream Maker's got something up the sleeve here. Carol, how are you?
I'm fine.
You doing
wonderful.
Good? You doing good? I tricked you both here. Look at me. I tricked you both here because I just have to honestly say I love you. You're a very sweet lady. What?
In shock.
You're in shock? Don't be in shock. In my Dream Maker book, there is a letter from your daughter. Did you know that your daughter wrote me?
No.
Carol, do you think that you could read this letter?
I could try. I don't know if I can,
okay.
But I could try.
Okay, you try, and then if you can't, I'll read it for you.
Okay. Dear Dream Maker, my mother is the kindest woman I have ever known. Her life has not been easy. At age 18, she got into a motorcycle accident and had to have one of her legs amputated years later as a result. She often ignores her own happiness in order to please the people around her. Although there are many jobs she could do, she's chosen to work with the elderly and physically challenged children. Her latest job is helping people find their way around the Orlando airport. My mother has helped so many people in her life. I want to find a way to help her in return.
Some letter. You got divorced. Your living style sort of kind of changed. Is that correct?
That's right.
You don't go to the doctors, do you? Why?
Well, I don't have health insurance, so
You have no health insurance. If I told you how many people in the United States had no health insurance, but still yet, with an artificial leg, you walk all around the Orlando airport. After a whole day, how do you feel?
Well, I'm a little sore, but, you know.
Your daughter tells me that you have had this artificial leg for 25 years.
That's right.
And it is in desperate need of repair, but you don't have the money. I read that and I said, here's a lady on her feet all day long with this artificial leg, and it hurts. And every day you have to feel pain. And I don't believe that anyone should feel pain every day. I want to make your life a little easier. I want you to be pain-free. And there is a man sitting around, I'm going to introduce you to him now, who's going to help you. Please welcome a very kind heart and kind soul wrapped in the name of Mr. Wayne Rosen. How are you? Thank you, dear. Wayne is the clinical coordinator for Southeast Florida Hanger Orthopedic Group. His company is giving, get ready for this, that leg, 25 years, that's a long time, isn't it?
It's an awful long time. Things have changed and we feel we can make your life better.
So, I'm going to tell you something. You have a heart of gold. You have a soul that helps people out. And now, you will have comfort and no pain with a brand new artificial leg. You okay? Thank you for writing this. Thank you.
A nice hand for Wayne. Hey, wait a minute. I'm not over yet. Lisa King, where is Lisa King? Hey, you know what? Get ready, Lisa, because it's time I'm gonna give away some prizes in the audience when we come back. To you, and maybe you, and maybe you, and maybe you. So excited about the time. It's audience time! Yeah! Okay. Sandra Perez. Sandra, Sandra. Come here. Hi. You didn't ask anything for yourself. You wanted something for your mom and dad. You wanted new carpet for the house. Jerry! Jerry! New carpet for the house.
Did I hurt you?
No, it's okay, I have two heads. I need Renee Shokin. Renee! Renee! Again, Renee didn't ask for anything except for your daughter. What did you want for your daughter?
I wanted her to have a keyboard because every time we go into Radio Shack, she wants to always play it, and it's her birthday. She'll be 13 in 3 days.
Jerry! A brand new keyboard!
There you go!
Lisa King! Lisa! Lisa! Hop over the carpeting. This is so sweet. Again, what an audience who just doesn't dream about themselves, but dreams about other people. Lisa, you want a bedroom set for your daughters.
Yes.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
Can you say 1, 2, 3 and look over there?
1, 2, 3.
Up with those curtains.
Take a look, it's Broy Hill's Torreon bedroom. It's a rustic combination of light pine and black metal accents for that unique Southwestern look.
Come on. We had a great time, everybody. Goodbye, and please...